Hi, my name is Martin Koehring. I'm the head of the Economist Group's World Ocean Initiative, which imagines an ocean in robust health and with a vital economy. The World Ocean Summit is an integral part of the work we do on accelerating sustainable ocean economy. You can find out more about the initiative's work, including coverage on key themes discussed during this summit on our website, ocean.economist.com. Welcome to this aquaculture track session on the role of seafood in creating a sustainable food future. I'm very excited about this session. It's such an important topic at the initiative. We cover this topic, sustainable seafood and sustainable food from the ocean regularly. So I'm very excited about this topic. According to research commissioned by the High Level Panel for a Sustainable Ocean Economy, by 2050, the ocean could provide over 6 times more food than it does today. But how can this be done in a way that is healthy, both for the planet and humans? I have a great guest today to discuss this topic. In fact, he is one of the authors of the high-level panel report I just mentioned, Christopher Goldner. He's assistant professor of planetary health and nutrition at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. As an ecologist and epidemiologist, his research investigates the human health impact of global environmental changes, with a lot of focus, of course, on food systems. His current research priorities include, for example, climate-driven fisheries impacts, the role of coral reef management in increasing access to seafood, and creating systems of climate-smart public health. You will find his full biography on the screen under this media player. So I'm very excited to get started in this conversation. I've been looking forward to this conversation for a while, Chris. So I'd like to start on the context, really, for why we're talking about sustainable seafood and why this is such an important topic. So looking a little bit at the wider topics, obviously you focus a lot on planetary health and your nutrition transition. Food production is the largest driver of environmental degradation and greenhouse gas emissions. At the same time, we're facing major nutritional challenges, such as the global rise of obesity, of course, which has nearly tripled since 1975. So Chris, in your research, you have focused a lot on the interlinkages between environmental change and food systems. What do you see as the biggest challenges facing food systems today, particularly regarding the ocean as a source of nutrition?
Thank you so much, Martin, for having me, first of all. So my main area of expertise is in planetary health, and that's very much how I kind of view the world. This field is dedicated to understanding the human health impacts of environmental change, whether that is biodiversity loss, climate change, land use change, urbanization. And the World Health Organization has estimated that roughly a quarter of the entire global burden of disease could be avoided through improved ecosystem management. And this, to me, provides an enormous opportunity for food-based and nature-based solutions. My particular research focuses on food systems, which ties together these ideas of environmental sustainability and public health. And really, one of the main issues is that by 2030, the world will have roughly 8.5 billion mouths to feed. By 2050, nearly 10 billion. The major challenge we face as a global community is how to produce food that is enough, safe, and nutritious, while at the same time staying within planetary boundaries. So let's take each of these issues separately. How can we make enough food? The world already produces enough food right now for everyone to eat an adequate amount of calories. But calories relate to the amount of energy that is in food, and this is often the way people think of nutritional adequacy. Yet the reason I added the word nutritious to what I said before is that there's so much more to food than calories. There is protein, there is minerals like iron and zinc and fatty acids, and these are critically important features of food for healthy metabolism, brain health, development, and immunity. So what you decide to eat is so much more than the number of calories. And aquatic foods, specifically foods like fish, shellfish, seaweeds that come from freshwater and also marine sources, all of these provide these types of nutrients in abundance. And so if we rank all of the different meats and we rank them by their key nutrients, then foods like bivalves, shellfish, anchovies, herring, mackerel, all of these things really top the list in terms of providing the most amount of nutritious elements. And so one of the other things to think about is that we also have to create food systems that stay within our planetary boundaries. All the food that is produced around the world has some sort of environmental impact. It uses fresh water, it takes up land or water space, it causes greenhouse gas emissions. some foods have more of an environmental impact than others. And here you can think of kind of beef production versus the impact of growing beans. The more land, water, and resources that are used, the worse that food will be for the environment. And so we have to keep in mind that food has environmental impacts, some more than others, and the way they are produced matters. And lastly, we really need to take into consideration climate change as this integral factor in limiting or altering food production. The past research in my lab group has shown that an increase in sea temperature will drive fish populations kind of from the equator to the poles. And it will increase ocean acidification, reduce oxygenation of the sea, causing fish to be smaller in size and schools to have fewer fish. And so global catch potential of these wild capture fisheries is expected to decline by around 25% by the end of the century, with some regions facing 40% declines by even 2050. So as a public health specialist, I see areas of vulnerability emerging around the tropics where food security and malnutrition is the worst, where we struggle with ocean governance, where plans for climate adaptation is least developed, and where there is a looming food crisis. So really what we need from an environmentally friendly food system is to produce enough safe and nutritious food for every person on the planet while minimizing these environmental impacts. And this is really challenging, and it will take coordinated efforts around the world and innovation really across sectors.
Yes, I mean, thanks a lot for highlighting these planetary boundaries as well. I mean, you mentioned that it's not just about having enough food and safe food, but also nutritious food, and that all within these planetary boundaries. And you highlighted that, you know, that food from the ocean is much more than just the number of calories. It's really about the quality of the food as well, protein, minerals, and so on. So it's really important to, you know, highlight this context in which we have this conversation about sustainable seafood. And I'd like to move on a bit and expand on this. I mean, the ocean is a sustainable source of food, and not just protein, but you know, other sources of nutrition. And as I mentioned in the introduction, you're one of the authors of a study on the future of food from the sea, commissioned by the High Level Panel for Sustainable Ocean Economy. The study shows that the ocean could provide over six times more food than it does today, equal to more than two-thirds of the animal protein needed to feed the future global population. But you did highlight as well, of course, that it's not just about protein. Could you expand a bit on why the ocean has this potential and why it is not fulfilling this potential yet?
Sure. So first, I just want to highlight that this work was led by Chris Costello, who was a fisheries economist from the University of California, Santa Barbara, and his entire team. I only played a small role in this panel's effort, but I learned a tremendous amount of how food from the sea can be harnessed for optimal production in the future. Right now, food from the sea represents only 17% of the current production of edible meat worldwide. And if we think about how the Green Revolution transformed terrestrial agriculture, we're really still waiting for a blue revolution to transform aquatic food production to help us meet its optimal potential. What our group did was ask, how much food can the ocean produce sustainably by 2050? And here it's really important to distinguish between two types of ocean food production. There's wild capture fisheries, and then there's aquaculture, in the case of the ocean, mariculture. So, as a team, we estimated these sustainable supply curves of aquatic foods that accounted for ecological, economic, regulatory, and technological constraints. And our calculations indicated that edible food from the sea could increase by 21 to 44 million tons by 2050, which is roughly a 36 to 74% increase compared to current yields. This represents 12 to 25% of the estimated increase in all meat needed to feed those roughly 10 billion people by 2050. So keep in mind that this work focused only on one type of aquaculture, and that much of the kind of current research that's been done lately really shows that the vast majority of future sustainable production could and should be produced in freshwater systems, which will greatly amplify the numbers that I mentioned. And if we take this high-level panel work product, this was really a key input in the recent research that I was the lead of, as the lead of the nutrition chapter for something called the Blue Foods Assessment. This assessment was led by the Stanford Center for Ocean Solutions and the Stockholm Resilience Center, and supported by the EAT Foundation, World Resources Institute, and Springer Nature. And as you mentioned and we've discussed, you kind of asked me to talk about protein, but here it's really not the most important thing to consider. In general, if a society has enough calories, they have enough protein. This means that if a country has enough food, then it really should generally have enough protein. However, there are diets globally that are still poor, and the main differentiator is often found in the micronutrients, the iron, the zinc, the vitamin A, the vitamin B12, etc. And as part of the Blue Food Assessment, my team calculated that nearly 200 million micronutrient deficiencies could be prevented if we increase the production of aquatic foods in a sustainable way. To me, this is such an exciting result because it showcases how increased food production done in a sustainable way could deliver these incredible improvements to public health.
Yes, this is amazing. I mean, the numbers you quote are really amazing, and particularly in the context of the micronutrient deficiencies that you mentioned. I mean, we have this double crisis in a way. We have obesity on the one hand, which is on the rise, but also we have micronutrient deficiencies and people not getting the quality nutrition that they need. So, you know, the potential that your research highlights in the Blue Food Assessment is incredible.
I guess just other thing to mention, Martin, mm-hmm. is that our research for the Blue Food Assessment not only showed that aquatic foods serve this really key role in filling micronutrient gaps, but it also serves this really unique role in slowing the nutrition transition, that it serves mm-hmm. as a substitute for many of these unhealthier meats, these kind of red meats or processed meats. It can displace their presence within food systems by increasing the production of affordable aquatic foods.
Mm. Yes, and often this is overlooked. I mean, this potential to replace more unhealthy foods and instead replacing them with more nutritious foods. So this is great to highlight. And I'd like to discuss a little bit, how we can actually make the most of this potential. You mentioned already the opportunities that sustainable aquaculture has, the huge potential for food from the ocean in general to address challenges such as micronutrient deficiencies, as we mentioned. But how can this potential for sustainable seafood be harnessed? Have you come across any innovative approaches to restore fish stocks, for example, and harness the ocean's full potential for sustainable seafood?
Yeah, there are so many different avenues to begin thinking about increasing aquatic food production, but two main ones come to mind. One pathway is to consider fisheries management reforms. If we can create management systems that allow fisheries time to rehabilitate themselves and then allow for sustainable harvest over time, then we can greatly increase production, particularly in areas that are currently overfished. These management reforms could include catch limits, quotas, or even marine protected areas. This trend in creating MPAs and allowing for kind of this internal protection to create spillover to adjacent areas is such an exciting kind of innovation to me. And by creating these co-beneficial solutions between conservation and public health, we can create plans to simultaneously create a healthy planet that can sustain a healthy human population. So protected areas shouldn't be considered just for marine spaces. They should also be considered for freshwater spaces, mangroves, wetlands, etc., because of all of the different benefits they can provide. Another pathway that we've discussed is to increase the production of aquatic foods by farming them through aquaculture. And I think this is especially hopeful if it can be done without converting intact ecosystems such as mangroves or coastal wetlands into farmed seascapes. So we must kind of focus our attention on developing sustainability practices that minimize their environmental impacts.
Great, thanks a lot, Chris. And it's important to highlight that it's both the kind of technological innovations, as you said, in terms of sustainable aquaculture, but also the kind of more structural ones, fishing management reforms, as you highlighted, and how they can combine conservation efforts with public health efforts. Just conscious of time, I wanted to ask you about a little bit about the outlook for the future. I mean, you have already highlighted some of the, the potential and the production increase, but also the potential in healthy nutrition from the ocean. And you discussed a little bit also the challenges facing blue food production. And, you know, against this potential that, you know, we have these challenges, and what makes you optimistic about the outlook for sustainable seafood? And you mentioned earlier planetary boundaries, climate change, and so on. So I'd really like to know, what are the key actions that need to be taken for this kind of optimistic future to become a reality?
I think thinking of this through a kind of co-benefits framework, as I mentioned, there are marine protected areas, but also this idea of the private sector or public sector really taking over aquaculture and developing it in a sustainable way. The future of the aquaculture industry right now is perfectly positioned to provide healthy, nutritious, and safe and sustainable food sources to a growing population. And as I mentioned earlier, some of those foods that are highest on micronutrient composition and delivery are also coincidentally the lowest in terms of environmental impact. And so I think that if the industry can kind of push forward with this, right now it's still about an order of magnitude lesser environmental impacts than other forms of meat, but it can still do more. The industry should focus on kind of minimizing fish feeds that are coming from pelagic fish or quote unquote trash fish. There's improvements that can be made around antibiotic use and around ecosystem conversion. But right now I see aquaculture as an enormously exciting kind of potential avenue for increasing production and staying within the limits of planetary boundaries. But the devil is really in the details. We need these transformations to work, both from the bottom up and from the top down. We need the kind of private and public sectors, but we also need people that are willing to transform their preferences and their diets to consider nutritious and sustainable foods. And I think that it's empowering in many ways to think about how the public could dictate the future preferences, to dictate and orient or direct what the industry actually moves forward into doing in the future. And aquaculture has transformed radically over the past few decades, and the feed conversion of kind of how much feed goes into producing a certain amount of meat is one of those examples. And I think if they keep pushing the limits there, there's kind of exciting new technologies with vegetarian feeds that have the exact same nutrient composition profile as aquafeeds that are developed through feed fish. I think some of these kind of matching technological innovation with also kind of keeping in mind this planetary health lens, we could really think of a future that ensures health and sustainability in perpetuity, which ultimately is really the goal of a lot of the work that I do.
Brilliant. And that's an optimistic scenario that is, it sounds realistic as well. I mean, because obviously we are all aware of the need to supply nutritious food, but also being aware of these planetary boundaries is crucial. And you mentioned that sustainable aquaculture is one of the ways to get there, but taking into account some of the caveats you mentioned, you know, feed innovations, for example, and technological innovations to really harness these co-benefits. Unfortunately, we have run out of time, but it's been really fascinating to talk to you, Chris. And I'd really like to thank you for all the insights you have provided today. I mean, obviously highlighting why this is such a relevant topic. I mean, providing not just enough food, safe food, nutritious food, but also food that stays within the planetary boundaries, all against this context of climate change. So I think, I mean, we have learned a lot today, and I'd really like to thank you again, Chris. And there's a lot more to discuss. Actually, we have a live Q&A with two great aquaculture speakers at the end of today, which will be the last session of the day, actually. I hope you will stay tuned in for this session and also enjoy the rest of the summit. Remember also to check relevant content on sustainable seafood and other topics from the World Ocean Initiative's website at ocean.economist.com. Thank you again, and enjoy the rest of the summit.
Thank you so much, Martin.